You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Just so you can fit in. Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, staring really blankly at the screen because I can't see without my glasses. I am joined... Oh, I can hear you, though. That's good. That's good to know for the whole mask, then. I'm joined on this occasion. For those watching the video version, it'll make all sense in the world. For those that listen to the audio, it will not. But I'm joined by the current Varsity Wrestling Junior Heavyweight Champion. It's Spike Tierney. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having us.
I'm going to take this off straight away because I can't see, and as always forget, it's really, really hot, this particular mask, and it makes me, well, it gives me hair for a moment. It's very nice. It's a time I don't remember very well, so give me a second. Oh. Worth it. Right. Well, welcome to the show. How are you doing?
Not too bad.
I feel like this is an episode that's been a long time coming. I feel like I should have had you on way before now, before season 7. But I think I contacted you to get you on, and then the big thing happened at Fair City, or vice versa. It was all close together anyway. Mm-hmm. I think it's a nice time to speak about that. But we'll do the boring stuff. We'll do the cliche questions before we get to that big point. Because you've done the Fair City podcast. The Fair City Wrestling one already?
Yeah.
I should know that. I didn't edit it, but I did put it up. Some of this will be kind of repeated answers from there, I'm sure, because Patrick, at the time, it was Duke, I think, that was hosting at the time. They've done a pretty good job at covering some bases when they were previewing shows. So if there's anything repeated, I apologize to the listeners, but, you know, suck it. We're going to listen to it anyway. Right. So, first cliche question is always, what was the moment that got you into wrestling? So what was the moment you watched, saw, how did you get into pro wrestling?
Well, first show I'd ever watched, it was WrestleMania 27, which is, it's quite late on, it was 2011.
Mm-hmm.
It all started, it was my mate, says, fancy staying at my house tonight, I'm staying up and watching the wrestling. And I was like, may as well, something to do. Seeing that show, and not very popular with wrestling fans, but I enjoyed it. I kept watching.
And what's that again? No blur.
Cena Miz main event.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, and on the, obviously the semi main event being Lawler versus Cole, that obviously must be up there as a main event match. Yeah, that wasn't the best time as a 10-year wrestling fan to be watching wrestling. But if it's your first one, your first proper show, then you don't know any better, kind of thing. It's the thing you enjoy at the time. Was there anyone that took your eye at the time that you were like, oh my god, this guy's cool, I'm going to keep watching for this person, or anything like that?
My favourites, sort of off the bat, Rey Mysterio, CM Punk, like the two of them.
Mm-hmm.
Then, not from that show, but a little bit later on, Zack Ryder caught my eye, and I really enjoyed watching him.
All right, well, Rey Mysterio, I as soon as I saw the card here, it was Cody Rhodes, Rey Mysterio, which is probably one of the few highlights of that actual show itself. God, that was Del Rio winning the Rumble that year. That was a very lean year for wrestling. Oh my. But anyway, so we did get a question that's kind of tied to that. I'll get to that in a bit, so we'll do the whole journey first. So that was your first experience. So did you know of anything beforehand? Did you know it was a thing, or was it just a case of your mate going, oh, I'm watching this, so you'd want to come over and watch it?
Well, I had never really watched anything before that. I knew it was a thing. Like, I'd seen his like trading card collection, that Slam Attacks, all that.
Oh, cool.
So I'd seen of wrestlers through that.
Mm-hmm.
That was really it.
I guess the first time I've had that. Usually when I'm speaking to people, it's the video games, the wrestling figures.
Mm-hmm.
The first person that's went Slam Attacks is the first experience of wrestling. Yeah. But if it gets you in, it gets you in at the end of the day.
Yeah.
So from that point onwards, then you got your favorites, you got your Punks, your Mysterios. Was it just seeking it out on Sky, YouTube, I suppose, was around about that time as well? It was becoming more of a staple for people's internet browsing history. Mm-hmm. So was it just head on to YouTube and type in WWE and hoping for the best?
Obviously, you got Raw, SmackDown, and that just on the TV, so I was able to watch them. Pay-per-views, I illegally streamed them. I didn't pay for them straight away until the network came around, and then obviously get the network, but that was quite a few years after.
Mm-hmm. I mean, folk like going crazy for things like legal streaming, which, you know, is bad, people.
Yeah.
I mean, WWE have turned like $1 billion profit, so I mean, you weren't really stealing much from them. But
I was also a child and didn't earn any money.
There's that as well. But I think it's the exact same concept as tape trading, which was still piracy. Mm-hmm. People just go, yeah. Oh yeah, we did tape trading. Like, that's still technically, you know, illegal at the time. I don't think you're going to go to jail for it. Trading a Japanese tape for a old NWA TNA pay per view, but still, you know, it's still technically doing that. So, catching all the wrestling, were you just immersed from that point onwards? Was it no going back, or were you one of those people that had a break? I mean, I suppose you're too young probably to have a break. You probably just rode out for all the.
Yeah. So I don't watch as much now. I'll sort of, like, nowadays I'll catch clips on Twitter and I'll dip in and out watching pay-per-views.
Mm.
But I haven't really had a break of not watching anything. So okay. I've always kept up with something and sort of know what's going on.
I find that with wrestlers, once they start becoming wrestlers and they kind of start mm-hmm. forming their own characters, that watching it's like a busman's holiday. You know, you do mm-hmm. wrestling training all day, you do wrestling at the weekends, and then the last thing you want to do is come home and watch more wrestling kind of thing. Mm-hmm. You want to just switch off for a day and recover and rest. But I mean, even for myself, because I'm doing all these kind of things and keeping mm-hmm. the website going, it's like the last thing I have time for is going, right, I'm going to carve out 3 hours of my day and watch the last pay-per-view. Because if I didn't watch it live, I'm not watching it. That's where I am now. I'll find the highlights. Twitter, I'll have a GIF that'll sum up the whole thing. It's all good. It's all done from there. So I didn't ask because I didn't want to feel really old. But so 2011, you said you were really young. What are we talking here?
So I was born in 2000. So 2011, I would have been 10, turning 11.
Okay, that's fine. It's still 10 years on me, but that doesn't make me feel so ancient. Mm-hmm. When you said WrestleMania 27, I was like, oh god, oh no, this is going to end badly. I'll never forget I can't remember who it was, but saying, oh, my first favorite was Jeff Hardy. I was like, oh cool, oh yeah, when he had his feud with CM Punk. I was like, no, not that.
Yeah.
No. Just that old Matt Damon thing from Saving Private Ryan, just turning into an old man. It was just so right about that time, then that's when I started getting into the local scene. So I don't know how we mm-hmm. were of a local scene at that point, where your parents were, or sort of poster. Did you know that there was a scene in and around you?
My first local show was 2012, so the year after, show in Perth with Roddy Piper, Tatanka, Teddy Biasi,
That was my first show. That was my one as well. Yeah, Cheers Center in Perth, mm-hmm. at the Ice Arena. That was an interest. That was a fun show. But yeah, it was a very strange introduction to wrestling when you
the big long break before for putting the cage up.
Oh yeah, the big long break and the cage wasn't put together right.
I don't think it fit the ring properly, which was the issue.
Oh yeah. Oh, I did the episode with Randy, and I think we went into it in quite detail because it fascinated me at the time, and it's now 12 years later, and I'm still kind of fascinated how badly it was planned. Just seeing it became a lumberjack cage match because all the wrestlers had to hold it for everything to happen. Oh, what a way! And yet he still came back, and I still came back, and we still still involved with Scottish wrestling in some way, me as a viewer and you as a actual doing the wrestling. Mm-hmm. So that was 12. You were 12 at that point.
Yeah.
Did you know at that point? Did you decide at that point going, yeah, I'm gonna give this a go? Did you have any inclination at that point?
I'd always had hope of doing it. Obviously at that time I knew myself, I'm way too young for doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So I did know, if I was ever going to do it, it would be quite a bit down the line.
We always were quite athletic, with trampolining and all that kind of stuff. What did the young people do? Did you do a sport? Because you're quite athletic anyway, with lots of flips and high flying. So is that always something you
did? I've anyway? Had a trampoline since I was 3 or 4. Mm-hmm. So I'd always been into doing all that and the gymnastics and stuff, and I'd done gymnastics in PE at school and that. I'd quite enjoyed that more than kicking a football about.
Mm-hmm. So that was your kind of, maybe subconsciously, that was your base training. You knew that once you're old enough, at least I can do some of the Marie Mysterio stuff for trying to pass as a high flyer around about 2010. Evan Bourne, you could do Evan Bourne stuff and all that.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. So we did get a question from Connor Stibbles about this. So this is kind of a good tie-in. He just put a match that made you decide to be a wrestler. So you knew you wanted to do it, but was there a specific moment or match that you were like, that's why I want to do it?
Nothing, no match specifically. Like I said, sort of known from the start, was like, oh, this is cool, this looks fun, I would like to do it. Matches that do come to mind quite early on was Money in the Bank that year, Punk and Cena.
Oh yeah, of course.
Mm-hmm. It's like watching that was yeah, cool, yeah, I'll do that.
Mm-hmm.
But not fully that match. It was just everything from around then.
Yeah, that was just part of the whole bigger picture of doing it. So I'm going to note down your debut being 2016. I did trust the Germans at first, and then I went onto the Fair City Wrestling social media, and it confirms October 2016. So that's 4 years of training. Debut at 16, then. So that's that's wrong. 2012 is when you started.
When I started watching, I had
2016. So when did you start going, right, I'm ready, I'm old enough, mm-hmm. I'm developed enough, I can go do this? When was that kind of?
So I started training January 2016. So at the time, I was 15, turning 16 that year. Started school in Dundee. Through the door straight away, everyone sort of knew who I was from watching the shows.
Mm.
So quite a few guys took us under their wing and helped us a lot that way. Luckily, I sort of picked everything up quite quick. Didn't take too long to learn anything. And then, it was October, I got my debut. That was right, you're ready.
That's mad. 10 months.
Yeah.
That's That doesn't seem long enough, especially for your kind of style anyway. But I don't know if you picked it up quick enough, then what's, who am I to judge? I've never done it myself. I've never even never even laid my back in the ring. That's way too before that, I think, did I remember rightly when we met at Ardley Mania afterwards, I did a couple things for the Dundee company, for the company that you trained at. Was I right in thinking that we met at one of those shows at some point, or you'd seen me do my 10th announcing at one of them?
I was around for those shows, yeah. I don't remember. I can't remember exactly which one. I think there was a Bonner Hall show where my mum spotted you outside. I think you might have had a broken wrist or something at the time.
Oh yeah, okay, cool. Yes, that was the, that was the
show. She spotted you. Oh, there's that boy after YouTube.
I'll take that. I've been called a lot worse. Yeah, that show. Who was on that? That was
Was that Doug Williams?
Yeah, yeah, Doug Williams on it, and Ted DiBiase, and was that the Road Warrior Animal one?
Possibly. Maybe Party Marty.
Oh god, it doesn't get any better, does it? Yeah. Oh god, that was 2014. So that was good while ago. Right. We'll move on from that. So your debut. was the mask always an idea? Was that always the inspiration? Because you saw Rey Mysterio and I'm guessing Straight Edge Society, CM Punk. Was that always something that you thought, right, when I'm going to be a wrestler, I'm going to be under the mask?
No, not really. It started, like, the idea came about when I started doing training matches rather than just drills. I was terrible at showing expression. So I had a still face through pretty much everything.
Mm-hmm.
So the way to combat that was put a mask on, hide that.
Right, okay.
And because I was, like, I'd done all the flips and that anyway, I was quite good at that stuff. It sort of made sense. I was like, this could work.
Am I right in thinking, right, remembering that the mask you had around about your debut was like a proper full face, mouth covered and everything? Was it a grey one?
It was like a black mask with a grey design on it. It was like a skull.
Yeah, I thought it was like a handprint or something, but Now, I wore that mask for not even a minute, and it's got eye holes and a mouth. How is it wrestling with your like, everything's impaired in that kind of mask? How did you find it to work, especially when you're only 10 months into training?
It did suck. A lot harder to breathe, get my breath. Like you say, the vision is quite impaired. Even the mask that I'm wearing just now, my vision's impaired. Like, I can only really see here.
Mm-hmm.
But that one, everything's covered. So it does suck, but I trained with it on quite a bit and sort of got used to it before going out on shows.
Right, so
yeah. I knew what I was in for.
And I mean, I've got your debut match being against Air Miles, which, you know, it's not like he's going to be a slow opponent for you, so that's not going to help with the whole, like, building up heat and perspiration inside a thing that you barely see out of and all that. So did you feel, when they said you were ready, did you feel like you were ready? And after the match, did you feel like you were ready for that debut?
Not really. My actual first match, it wasn't an uprising. It was in Edinburgh. We were the Three Sisters Bar, so it was like an outdoor show.
All right, okay.
It was actually you and Mackie. He came up to us and was like, look, we're short on guys. I'm going to let you wrestle Air Miles. So, on finding that out on the day, I was like, well, yeah. I don't think I'm ready for this, but we'll sort something out. I'll go out and I'll wrestle this match. Something obviously went well, because then we'd done the same match just a week or two later. I'm sure it was the Ted DiBiase show that year. We did essentially just do the same match.
I suppose when it comes to things like, there's a bit of feedback. I don't know what's happening there. So occasionally when I start speaking, mm-hmm. it was really loud at someone's end. I don't know if it's mine or yours. But I suppose when it comes to a gala show or the likes of that, a beer festival, whatever it was, you can get away with not being as smooth as you need to be, because generally the people that are there won't be wrestling fans. They're just going...
Oh, they definitely weren't. the biggest flop came from a super kick.
Kicking people in the head. That's it. Yeah. Kick. That's all you need. Who needs to do all the 450s and the big flips when you can just kick someone and give them a stunner? RKO. That's it. Big pop of the day. So from that point onwards, you're featured quite often down there against a plethora of different opponents from different experiences as well. Did you find it after that first match, or first two matches you have there, Miles, from that point onwards, was there less pressure each time? Did you find that the opponents you're working with were able to adapt to your style? You were able to use your inexperience, but gain more experience as you're working with these people?
So I had those first two matches with Miles. I actually thought after them was like cool. I've been given this match. It was a training experience. That's probably it, and I'll need to wait a wee bit longer. So I turned up for the next show after that, and Martin Stallion walks up and goes, "It's me and you tonight." Saying I have that match with Stallion, and that was a good learning experience.
I'm intrigued that it seems to be a case of that you're just getting told. I don't know the inner workings of wrestling too much outside of what you read, but do you thrive off not having a lot of time that you can kind of call it on the fly, being able to trust who you're with? Is that something that you enjoy doing, or would you like at least maybe a day or two to know what you're doing and what you're coming up against?
A lot more now than then, but I do enjoy just finding out and doing it. I know, because past wee while I've been working with newer guys, like the match with J. Robin, he's obviously not as experienced as I am.
Mm-hmm.
He certainly likes going over things beforehand. But I do like just like cool and into it.
See, that's the biggest thing that terrifies me about. I would never be a wrestler because I've a memory of a sieve. So I'd come in and go, right, nah, we're stopping now. Let's just have a wee stand, think, what's happening next? Come on, right? Okay, cool. We'll do 5 minutes. I'll remember that. You could go, which I know would be the worst thing you'd ever want to hear as a wrestler, would be to go, No, hang on. What are we doing? and then just like halt everything. So soon after you're in a tag team, supercharged, so that got you. You're able to get a bit more ring time, but not have to do as much of the work, which I suppose is always a plus. And you find, because it was two masked guys, so it's always going to be a fan favorite team. That's just how wrestling works. Did you find that the more you're able to do that as a tag team, you're able to maybe use your body more to express yourself, and you're able to get that bit that was missing? Maybe not the facials, but at least you're able to use your body more to express whatever feelings and selling, whatever you need to do.
Definitely, yeah. Just being in the tag team certainly helped a lot early on.
I'm just looking through some of your opponents. Some of them I can't mention. One certainly for legal reasons. But there's a good few. Kevin Williams that you come across early, which, you know, who's a big factor in Fear City Wrestling now. And scrolling. scrolling. But no, you got the Scumbucks as well with Ian Ambrose and JD Wild. So you're coming in with, again, it's getting that all that experience in, and especially with a guy like Ambrose, who's Wild as well, JD Wild. They were two high flying guys, or could do the high flying if required, that you're able to match up with. Did you prefer going up against those kind of guys where you can kind of match wits with the high flying, or when you're coming in with Kevin Williams, where you're the Rey Mysterio to the big guy, kind of thing, the big power guy? Is there a preferred dynamic that you like when it comes into wrestling?
I do enjoy both. Working against other high flyers is definitely more fun for me. Bouncing off each other and sort of the, like, nowadays you can look and describe it as Osprey Ricochet.
Mm-hmm.
Like that sort of stuff. With JD as well, he was early on, he was one of the big, like, bigger guys. It was like, come on, you're one of my guys.
Mm-hmm.
It's like getting to do that with him as well was a lot of fun.
So from that point, I mean, I was seeing your opponents here with the likes of Yuri Maki, who you mentioned already, that you had one of your first matches with, Kenny Kidd. There's quite a few guys that you came across later on as well. During this time, you were kind of starting to also work Fair City wrestling shows. So this is where we'll kind of jump over to Fair City. So it started, was it 2019, end of 2019, Fair City wrestling started?
I believe so, yeah.
Were you on their first show, or was it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So was it a no-brainer when they approached you? Because at the time, they had quite close ties with the promotions.
Mm-hmm.
Was it, I've seen who you're up against. A lot of very familiar names at that time in that area, like your John Kerr, Ollie Silverstone, who disappeared, and then Tyler Jr. Suddenly appeared. I don't know what happened there. And Tommy Cross. So... yeah, what was it like going over to work in Fair City?
That was a lot of fun as well. There was some crossovers with audience members coming to both shows,
mm-hmm.
but for the most part, it was a new audience, more people watching. So just getting to do what I do in front of new people was a ton of fun.
Before I get into that, then we'll go back to the masks. So that one, you're all black and grey number. That went, and you had a mask before that one, if I remember rightly, that was like it was a bit ill fitting, if I remember rightly. Kind of, I can't remember it off the top of my head exactly. But when it came to the masks, did you once you got rid of that one, the full face one, were you starting to design your own? Were you trying to find a mask maker? What was the kind of process before you got to the one you've got now?
So the in-between mask, that one was, like you mentioned, Supercharged. So the mask I wore for Supercharged was the same design as Scotty's.
Oh,
but
yeah.
But I did spikes to the top of it.
Of course, you're called Spike. That makes sense.
Yeah. So that was the in-between mask. And then it was... so it was the skull mask, the Supercharged mask, and then I went to this one.
So for the design, was it something you particularly wanted on there? Was it something that you drew out and sent off, or was it one you saw online and you went, that's the one I'll have?
This is the old Amazon classic.
Right. Okay. I mean, it fits pretty well for an Amazon purchase. I mean, I do remember the Supercharged one, and it was like hung off the sides a little bit, and yeah, the spikes.
Because of the spikes, they were like Scotty done it himself. He cut the mask open, glued the spikes on.
Right.
But when they were glued on, it brought the top up, so it didn't really tie the best. It did fall off a couple of times during some like rumbles and that. So eventually, we added Velcro to the back and tried to joy it up like that.
Oh, amazing. The amazing ways you get past things in wrestling, just going, I'll be fine. Velcro, sorted, all done. Right. Okay. We'll move on to Fair City then. So you were brought in pretty much in their junior heavyweight division. It was, I don't think it was called that particularly at the time because the belt was there because there was a tournament coming up. So you came in and got a lot of high flying guys and smaller guys. And was that your bread? You said you like facing high flyer guys. Was that just like your bread and butter? Was that perfect? You're like, yes, that's exactly what I want.
Yeah.
Especially with a guy like Ollie Silverstone. I remember a match you had with Ollie was voted like our match of the month that particular month. And
yeah, it's still one of my favorites.
So from that going forwards, your junior heavyweight title into the semi-finals, into the finals, but unfortunately, no, it was the semi-finals, and then pandemic happened, wasn't it? So nothing resolved.
I actually did make it to the finals.
Mm-hmm.
I think we've sort of retconned the tournament from history now. But it was Ollie Silverstone was quarterfinals, put us in at the semis. Then I wrestled Alex Kavanagh.
Of course.
And I beat him and then qualified for the finals.
And then a pandemic happened. And
then pandemic happened, yeah.
Everything stopped and everyone fell out with each other and nothing happened. So someone who's been wrestling at that point for 4 years, then having nothing, no wrestling at all, how did you fill your time? Was it just you said you didn't watch as much, but did you end up starting watching again? How did you keep that wrestling like thing ticking over?
I did sort of watch more during that time. I managed to get myself seats in the Thunderdome here and there.
Oh yeah, that was fun.
Aye. So I was on quite a few of the Thunderdome shows.
Did you wear the mask?
I didn't.
Oh, there you go. There's those Thunderdome shows. They were a time in life. Best way. I didn't pay for my network for a year because I was just signing up to the Thunderdome so I could just watch it live. Sitting in this room, actually, most of the time I was just sitting in this room watching on my computer and thinking, oh, they can't hear me, and then swearing and then getting booted. I didn't know that was a thing until it happened. But those Thunderdome shows, there were, going back now with hindsight, God, they were a tough watch, weren't they?
Yeah.
Just, I mean, wrestling needs a crowd. That's what we learned. Yeah. I mean, at the time it was great. We could watch wrestling, ace, wonderful, let's do this, it's free. Don't have to pay $9.99 to watch it. But God, staying up, trying to watch a laptop and then watch the TV because the laptop was live. But the TV on the network was like 10 seconds out. So you didn't know what to do and what to react to. And you're sitting going, what the fuck are we doing here?
Especially when it was like Monday Night Raw or whatever. Not want to lose your seat, so needing to sit through main event beforehand. And
I tried to watch one Raw, and I was like, nah, no, not doing this. I'll stick with the pay per views. I've got work. I mean, I didn't care about work in the morning because I was working from home because of a pandemic. But I was like, nah, even Mondays, nah, I'm not doing this. I got about 45 minutes in, I had to go through a taping a main event as well, and I was like, no. I'm just gonna tap out at this point. Someone could take my seat way back in the rafters, and because that happened a lot, you got really excited when you saw yourself. You're like, yes, yes, and then next time you look, you're gone. Like, what the hell? Anyway, so that was 2 years ish of your life, Thunderdoming.
Yeah.
When did you go back to training? Was it as soon as you knew you could do one-to-ones? Was it just? What happened?
Essentially, yeah. As soon as I was allowed to, I was back in a ring. I did start back with the Bad Place. I was still with them for a wee bit longer than I should have been. But I was still, I still got on with everyone. I wasn't the guy that fell out with this person over that thing or whatever. At that point, I was still sort of in the middle, friends with both sides.
Yeah. I mean, from what I'm getting from you from this chat is you're pretty laid back when it comes to it all. So you're just like, right, okay, I just, you know, if something happens that I'm aware of and I see, then okay, I'll deal with it. But until then, I just want to be able to wrestle. So I'm going to go and wrestle. But eventually I ended up, okay, just going Fair City all the way. You don't need to discuss the reasons, that's not this podcast about with any slinging or whatnot, but you decided, and that was that. You were a Fair City boy. And from that point onwards, the shows came back. Were you hyped? I think it was a tag match. Was it your first match back? And you were now in a new tag team with a new masked person called Bochico. And interesting fella is Bochico. I heard the most recent FCW podcast that went out at the time of this recording. Because I like to tell people it's March 9th, so this is going to be well, WrestleMania is well gone and past. Cody Rhodes may or may not be WWE Universal Heavyweight Mountain Dew champion. So I lost my point there. Yeah. So Bochico, interesting fella. Mm-hmm. Lots of facts that he likes to throw in there. You were part of Flips and Slips. Yeah. Was that a case of you kind of bringing Bochico up, like mentoring him? Or was it a case of maybe just getting back on your feet a little bit, getting some rust off? You wanted to do a little bit of tag teaming. What was the... How did Flips and Slips come to be?
We're actually first tagged for W3L at Gala Day. We had that match. And then from there, we were like, you know what, this could work. Sort of gelled well.
Mm.
That would have been pre-pandemic, that Gala Day. So then when I came back to Fair City, post-pandemic, the spot was sort of there. And we were like, oh yeah, we'll do this. That's could be a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. And there seemed to be that this is when their tag division was kind of just starting to lay the foundations for the future as well. Pardon the pun for the current FCW Tag Team Champions. There we go. But yeah, so the foundation was starting for that. Much like when you started at FCW, the foundations were being brought in for the Junior Heavyweight Championship and you were kind of into that division. So the tag division came around, you're like, oh, okay, cool. I'll throw myself into that. Again, with the laid backness to it, do you worry about any like your spot, or do you just want to be on the show and just having a match?
I'm quite easygoing, and I'm happy doing whatever gets asked of us.
Mm-hmm. It's just what love of the game is that the phrase that the kids use nowadays for that sort of thing. There was a match that I brought up with Tom Atlas. This isn't FCW related. It's Source, because it tickled me at the time. Team FCW defeating Team Source. So
yeah,
as I said that to Tom, made Source look a bit rubbish if their trainees lose on their own trainee show. But you know, that we'll move on from there. But the interesting thing he pointed out that I didn't realize at the time was the team. So we'll get into it proper in a little bit when we get to the big conclusion, but the team of yourself, Tom Atlas, Duke Cannon, and Sebastian Asher. Now, has this always been like kind of a training? Has this always been like a little bit of a group that you've always had training wise, or were they kind of your SW guys? What was the kind of
that match at Source was sort of the beginnings of it.
Mm-hmm.
The four of us were always, so like, if somebody got in touch with Kevin Williams and says, do you have any guys that can fill a spot on our show for us? We were the four that Kev would go to.
Mm-hmm.
Like, right, are you guys free to fill this spot? If so, you have the spot. So for that show, it was, I need four guys. Kev came to us. Do you guys want to fill this spot? and we were all available, we all went. It was a good day out.
And you came away with a win, which is always always good. But we'll probably tail back to that, because I think that's more, a very important thing we'll come back to later on, because I'm still going through the little in and out of timelines here. Like, because you had your debut in England the month before that. I think it was your debut, but you didn't match in England. So another promotion, another country, over the border. How do you find that it is in front of new crowds, being so used to, I don't know how it differs between Scottish and English crowds, where Scottish crowds are a bit more willing to shout things at you, whether you're supposed to be cheered or booed, or English crowds are a bit more reserved in any way. But a debut for an English company, different crowd, how was that experience for you? Bit of travelling as well.
I really enjoyed it. It's quite easy for me, having like the mask and everything. It sort of, because it's different to them, they don't see that often. Sort of drew them towards me, and I was able to get them in the palm of my hand straight away. So as soon as I came through that curtain, they were already right up for it, cheering, already behind us. So like I say, it's quite easy in that sense.
I think it's probably more difficult, maybe what you're doing, what you'll be doing going forward is trying to get people to boo you when you come out wearing a mask, because you're right, masks are so woven into wrestling history, where if you see a guy come out with a mask, you're like, ah, oh, that guy's cool, he's got a mask, masks are cool. So yeah, so it's probably a bit more, what you're going to do now is probably going to be a bit more of a challenge, but by the time this comes out, we'll have seen the first chapter of it, and we'll see it on Empire probably round about this week when this goes out. We'll probably have one round about that time. So the next match I've noted is a match that I think would be probably a big one for you, from you watching the shows to this match with Ian Ambrose. You wrestled the Scumbucks, but this was against the Scumbucks. This is a one-on-one match with Ian, someone you would have seen on that first show in 2012. As part of a tag team match in that amazing cage match, which still in my mind to this day. So was that a match that, do you hold that particularly special? What was your thoughts going into it as someone who's kind of helped you along the way as well? A match with Ian, that's in my head, it's a big match for you, whether you think it is or not. It's for you.
It definitely was. Ian is quite similar to me. He's quite laid back with everything in that sort of way. So I found out, because he at the time was obviously wasn't injured at the time, so he was taking training classes at DAPW. So we were able to sort of get together there and just be like, yeah, cool, we can do this, we can do that, sort of. Here and there.
I know, it's because you put up quite a lot of training clips and stuff like that, and there was always, it's always a similar looking fella to you build wise. I don't know if it's the same guy, but he seemed to be working with this particular person quite a lot, to work on little things here and there. So when it came to this match, it was just all about speaking to the guy that he was training with and just putting it all together into one.
At the time as well, he was starting to get more into doing the sort of lucha style of wrestling. He was hitting more hurricane runners. He was doing more springboard stuff like that. So we had a lot of fun, sort of, because that's the stuff I've been doing for all these years, that I was able to help him with that. So getting to be in the match with him, that he gets to do a lot more of this stuff, was definitely up there.
Next one I've got, I seem to be, this is very strict, I don't know how I'm doing this, it's quite strictly going timeline here, but the next one that match got noted is your junior heavyweight title number one contender match, because this is okay, we're building up to the big thing, which is the title win. Very interesting. Who was in that four-way, for those that are unaware. It was at the Queen's Hotel. It was Spike Tierney defeating Duke Cannon, Sebastian Asher, and Tom Atlas. So this is layers. There's layers upon layers in this that I didn't realize. And I'm looking forward to the big montage cut that if FCW or whoever is in charge, if Marcus Hunter decides to throw some money somewhere, makes a montage of these humble beginnings going from that team to the big four way and then winning the title. It's just incredible. This is just so I'm really excited because I'm just like learning things as I go here. Because I noticed there was a picture when I was again doing a little bit of research, and it was when you won the match, the number one cares match. Mm-hmm. It was yourself celebrating, hands raised by Duke Cannon and Tom Atlas. Like, God, I love wrestling. This is the kind of stuff I like. When I enjoy flips, so I'm not going to say you can do all your flips because that's what you do. But you do all that. Give me a bit of story, and this is story all over over the place. This is 2 years in the making, and by the time this comes out, hopefully someone's already made that montage and everyone knows the backstory, and I'm not just spoiling everything for you. So number one contender, junior heavyweight title, going up against Taylor Bryden, an opponent that you wrestled in the past as well, when there was a crossover show involving WTL. Bryden was one of those guys, or is one of those guys, who's like a different breed of wrestler, it seems, at the moment. If you give his hand to just about anything that you give him, kind of thing.
Yeah. And
for initially, first day of Rumble, you lost the one-on-one match for the title. But did you think that must be one of your first proper big title matches? How did you feel about the match?
I did enjoy it. It was a really good learning experience. I did walk out of the match, bloody nose, blood dripping. But again, I learned a lot from it. Taylor's one of those guys that you go in there, you know, going in, like, he does pre-warn you, was like, I hit hard.
And he expects to be hit back just as hard. Yeah, if not harder. So he knows where his kind of boundary is for hitting, that kind of thing. Are you happy to get into that kind of slugfest of throwing it back harder?
Definitely.
I suppose at that point, if someone's hit you really hard, you're going, well, I'm just going to have to fucking hit you now, because that's just, you're going to have to know that I will hit you back. So, but it didn't matter, though, because 2 months later, or no, not even that, my timelines are all over the place. 4 months later.
So Rumble would have been October. I took the belt in February.
So I've gone by the old calendar because I'm ancient. I'm missing out 2 months, July and August, clearly. But you became junior heavyweight champion, a big four-way involving champion Taylor Bryden, Nathan North, and here he is again, Tom Atlas.
Yeah.
He's always watching, he's always there. So as someone who's probably junior heavyweight by design for your style as well, being high flyer, you often see that in heavyweights. What was it like? I don't know, are you a belt guy? Are you a guy you got it behind you, but are you a guy treasures winning a championship? What was it like getting your hands on your first proper bit of gold?
There was tears. the three count happened. The rest of the guys left the ring. I was left there on my own with the belt. John Young, obviously, owns Fair City Wrestling. He got in the ring. They brought Mum in at the ring. So Mum was there. And like I say, I don't know if breakdown is the right description, but I did. There was tears. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's a big moment. Regardless of what you think of wrestling, you know, just going, oh, it's this, it's that, it's that. But it's still, at the end of the day, you're still being trusted as being a champion for the vision that FCW was very prideful in. in that division, junior heavyweight title, especially because it was the first belt for my brother. Or yeah, it was the first belt because then the heavyweight came afterwards, I think. So,
yeah.
So they put a lot of pride in that.
Mm-hmm.
And you got a nameplate, which again, yeah. I love. That's the sort of little things I like in wrestling. You know, mm-hmm. wrestling secondary. Give me the little things. That's why I like. So you got a little nameplate, and well, you're still the current champion at this point. Mm-hmm. I mean, there was a bit of an awkward moment, awkward period in the middle. But you know, we'll get to that. But yeah, so being a champion, you got behind you, hung up. But are you mm-hmm. are you the guy that? How long did you wait around the house? That's the big question here. Any chance you get, kind of thing.
I mean, it was set up on the kitchen table for a wee bit because, like, my mom had people over, my sister had people over. It was like, look at the belt that he's won, and then from there, it was sort of. It's like to the side of me here, I've got a stack of old WrestleCrate boxes. So it was set up on there for a while. And then it was just Christmas past there that Mom got us the bracket to put up there.
I love how pretty, I mean, because your mum was taking you to the shows over 10 years ago at that point. So, and I know your sister's a big fan of the wrestling as well.
Mm-hmm.
The wrestling. Yep, just taking all those old man boxes, right? There we go. So it must be great for... It's a really great family dynamic. There's no case of going, oh, you shouldn't do this, because all of yous just adore wrestling. So
mm-hmm.
when it comes to, like obviously, getting your mom getting her friends around and going, look, you want a belt and all that kind of stuff. Is your mom someone that you kind of maybe throw ideas at? Someone who's watched wrestling for as long as... she has. Do you throw ideas at her, or are you just a typical just child going, oh mum, you're fine, you enjoy getting your friends to look at the belt, it's fine, I'll deal with mm-hmm. the actual wrestling bit because I'm doing the wrestling.
I keep her completely in the dark. She doesn't know anything going on, like storyline wise or what's happening in matches or that. She actually prefers it that way as well.
I was going to say,
she prefers being on the other side of the barrier.
So, I mean, because then you get a natural reaction as well. The last mm-hmm. thing that she would want, like, I've had very, very brief interactions with your mum, but I always get the vibe that I sound mm-hmm. really creepy or out loud when in the head. But she's very much a natural reactor to moments and stuff like that. And I think if she knew that you were doing this, you were going to win or anything like that, that would maybe spoil it for her, even though mm-hmm. you know, she's still getting to see you win, but it would be like, oh, but I knew already, kind of thing.
Yeah.
I mean, your mum sounded way older than she is in that moment. I'm just digging myself a hole here. I'm just going to just start climbing out. So you are junior heavyweight champion at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And you have been since then. Other than a very, very awkward point where stuff happened with injuries, which we'll touch on, but it'll touch on as much as you want to touch upon. Mm-hmm. Next point I've got is April that year. So this is last year, 2023, we're talking mm-hmm. about, was the return to the Ardler Complex for Fair City Wrestling. So Ardler Complex, I know that it's a quite a very important venue for your development as a wrestler, because it's a place you mm-hmm. miss that quite a lot. I mean, I know myself, when I went back there last September, it was like, oh my God, it's nostalgia getting thrown at me for all the still times I've been down here. What was it like going back there after all the shenanigans that had led up to that point, getting back into the Ardler Complex for the first time, but with a new paint of coat, a new promotion?
I loved it. It was weird leading up to it, because obviously advertising the show, the FCW page, they were putting up the poster and put up their descriptions featuring Ardler wrestling legends Ian Ambrose, GD Wild, Spike Tierney.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, I shouldn't be in that list, but at the same time, it's like, I was there, so it just felt weird for me. being under the sort of legends section.
But so getting back there, it's such a weird venue. It's not a weird venue, but it's I know for myself going back there, it was like it felt like nothing had changed. You know, it was just a wrestling show, and the vent like the lines were still just as faded and all that kind of stuff, and get back in. So for yourself, when you're going to these places like back to the Ardler or Telic Institute or Tayport, is that a thing that you take into account when you go to a venue, or do you just kind of look at the roof and just go, right, okay, I can't do as much high flying as I want to? Is there anything about a venue that you take into account when you're getting prepared for a match?
Not really. Only just like you mentioned, roof height, like Queen's Hotel. I can't go in and hit all these top rope moves that I would normally hit. I was lucky enough one match in the Queen's Hotel. I was wrestling Eddie Devine, and I was able to get up the top rope and hit a swanton. Don't know how I managed it, but I managed it. So, but that's really the only thing I would look for is sort of roof heights. Like, can I hit? Can I go for this? Can I go for that?
Mm-hmm. So yeah, you made your turn to the Ardler Complex, and you as a wrestling legend at that point. and then not long after, you were against Solar, which again,
mm-hmm.
talking about guys that match your style, but this is a guy that's pretty much is your style perfectly, mm-hmm. including the mask as well.
Mm-hmm.
Was Solar a guy when you were starting wrestling? I assume you would have looked at maybe some of the local guys in the scene, maybe the mask guys specifically. Did you approach any of these guys beforehand to kind of get some tips in wrestling with the mask, or was that all stuff you kind of picked up along the way?
I did watch stuff from some of the guys, but for myself, it was a lot of just pick it up as I go.
But yeah, match of Solar. So again, that's just like, yeah, quite a big. We talked about Ian Ambrose being kind of an emotional big match because it's a guy that's mentored you and been a long time. But Solar being he was the mask guy for a long time in Scottish wrestling specifically. What did you take away anything specific from that match itself, or again, was it just another learning experience along the way?
No, I picked up quite a bit because he's like, there's a lot of guys now that wear masks and do flips, but he's actually does lucha rather than just flips. So like, he's studied the Mexican style and worked from that. So it was good to get in there with somebody like that rather than just somebody that does flips.
Yeah, I see. Somebody who's able to kind of link it all together instead of just going one flip here, do that then.
Mm-hmm.
So he knows how to kind of put it all and put it into a sequence rather than that.
Yeah.
But I was checking your opponents for your junior heavyweight title defenses, and geez, you fair hit a lot of variety. Likes of, mentioned Solar there, Zach Swift, who's a bit more grounded. You got Duke, you got Air Miles. Again, that's kind of a callback to your beginnings. Grant McIver, who's very much technical, going down and twist you. TV's Omar Muhammad before he was on TV. No, he was. I don't think he'd be on TV at that point, had he? He wasn't on Family Fortunes. Judge Judy and whatnot. So you really had quite a variety of opponents. Did you have any input on who you wanted to face at all, or was it all a case of you saw the poster graphic go up and you go, oh, okay, I've got Grant McIver this month, or I've got Rich Money. Did you have any input on your opponents?
Not really, but then I'm not the type of guy to go up and say, can I wrestle this guy or whatever. I will happily just sit back, let the matches that are planned to happen just happen.
So we're going to get into the match with Nitro Green then, because that's that's where this kind of all shenanigans started happening.
Yeah.
It was ruled no contest. Nitro Green, of course, a European wrestler. Again, cool mask. Very cool mask, very cool style. I don't know what happened during this match. I just know there was a post afterwards of it being called off because of an issue that you were taken hostile for. Do you know what happened? Do you know what happened in that match specifically? Have you watched back?
I've watched it back. What happened was he hit me with a forearm. And from that, I was just out cold. I had Brian Lang, he was reffing the match. He was right over to me and was like sort of checking on us, seeing if it was okay. Looking back now, it clearly wasn't. But at the time, I was like, let's finish the match.
Yeah.
But he made the right call. He called the match off. I was taken to the hospital and was diagnosed with a severe concussion.
It's mad. So it was just a freak accident then, a freak shot that hit the wrong way, especially when you're going through matches with Bright. Brighton must have been sitting watching that going, Jesus, how hard does he hit if he's just not knocked the fuck out? That's crazy. But no, again, safety first and all that, you're taken away. And it's all the flips and high-flying things you do, and it's a forearm to the face, and that's you out.
Yeah.
That's wild. I've never had a concussion that I'm aware of. I might still be suffering from one from years ago. And that's why I'm all kind of confused most of the time. Mm-hmm. But is that your first big concussion? Was it your first kind of proper injury in wrestling that was it?
My first one was, would have been, I think, end of 2017. It wasn't like massive or anything. I tore some tendons in my foot and my ankle. So I was out a couple months with that. Then the concussion would have been the first like big one, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And what was the kind of recovery for that? Was it just a case of rest, were you retested, or was there just, when the headache stopped, you were free to go? What was the
kind of recovery? I was completely out for 6 weeks. Once those 6 weeks were up, came back to training, sort of took everything lightly, tried sort of like baby bumps and that, see how they feel. Once they felt all right, I was back up taking full bumps and just sort of taking it easy until I was good to go.
I feel like then when I'm seeing who your next opponent was in Tayport, it was you and G Mackey. Was that feels like it's a safe opponent to go in with if you weren't right, if you weren't 100% at that point. At least you know you've been with someone who's very experienced that can recognize if something's not right, or can at least work around to finish a match if needs be.
Mm-hmm.
Again, was that, do you know if that was a conscious choice to put you in with you and because of that, those reasons?
Possibly. I know myself, I've wrestled Maki more than I've wrestled anyone else.
Mm-hmm.
So it was probably a case of like, that was kept in mind. He's a good guy to go to. We've wrestled each other that much that we can go in and put anything together and be all right with it.
Yeah, bit of muscle memory.
Yeah. Then he obviously wrestled the match. That match he done as Mega Mackie Z. So he came out, was all make-upped up and had his wings and came out to chandelier.
He's a very intriguing man, is Yuji Mackie. That's,
yeah.
I think that's the best way to put it, intriguing, because you never know quite what you're going to get with him, with Mackie, but I'm always entertained by him. Who'd say that? So back to Ardler, big undisputed junior heavyweight championship match with Sebastian Asher, who'd stolen the title during your injury, your layoff. So I was there for this match.
Mm-hmm.
So that was exciting. I remember at the time, I put it in the review. It was one of those matches where I wasn't at. I had such a shiter of a day anyway that I got there. I wasn't like, I felt like I wasn't in the mood for wrestling, which is the worst way to go into a wrestling show. And I came out of it going, I'm not sure about that match. And then I bought it on Patreon. I was like, I was wrong. I was a great match. What was I? I must have had a bloody buses. I was on buses. That was just the worst thing. Anyway, but yeah, it was a great match with Sebastian. I don't know if I'm right in saying this, but was there a scare in the middle of it with a suplex or something like that that seemed to knock Asher loopy as well? So I don't know if at one point you may have been like, oh shit. Back to the title matches and someone's going to get knocked out, and at least it's not me this time.
there was a couple of things in the match that didn't go as we wanted them to. We were sort of cut for time a bit.
So I heard. Yep.
Yeah. There was a match that was supposed to go 20 that went 40. So we had to cut quite a bit and rush through what we had left. So rushing through it.
Still good.
Yeah,
it was still good. But yeah, there was a moment where I saw, I was like, oh God, Asher, is Asher okay? I don't like having sympathy for Sebastian Asher. That's something that feels unnatural. But no, it was on rewatch. I was like, yeah, that's great. I'm glad I didn't do any writing the day after, because I was like, every match I had a problem with, I was like, oh, this sucked as well. And then now watching it back with a clear head going, God, Billy was a dick that day. I'm glad that glad he wasn't writing that shit back in September. So yeah, back in full swing, isn't it? Champion, defending again. And as of last month or 2 months ago, as this goes out, I get a bad guy now. So
yeah.
How dare you? So we do have questions about that though, so we'll get into those. We'll start with Patrick Patierski. With a nice simple one. What the hell did Duke, the one and only, say to you to convince you to join his cabal?
It wasn't Duke.
Oh, there we go. I mean, this is probably all revealed by the time that this comes out, but still. Mystery.
Yeah, we've had this in the works for, like you say, it's been 2 years now. Since then, the four of us have known that we were always going to be together, and the reasons for us coming together, and yeah.
There you go, Patrick. That's a bit of mystery for you to find out before, if you're listening to on Patreon, before April 5th. It is interesting. So again, finding out these little bits, the photo, the team FCW, and all that kind of stuff. It's so intriguing, and it seems to like one. You've all gone one at a time. So Asher was always the asshole. He was always the guy, the antagonist. But slowly, slowly, Tom went, and then Duke, and then yourself. And it's just, I'm very interested to see where this goes. That's all I'm going to say about that. Outside of that, we've got some very controversial questions. I have many questions to follow up with, but we'll get to that in a sec. Back to wrestling. We've got Daniel Mechka, you know. I think him and Patrick would get along. But he's put, who would you like to see step up next and challenge you for the junior heavyweight title?
Anyone. Like I've mentioned before,
just give you some your opponent. Sorry, no, I just give you an opponent. I'm not going, no, tell me, give me an answer.
Yeah.
But I didn't want to turn into I've been a dick here, just going, no, answer the damn question.
No, yeah.
But is there anyone in particular that from, I don't know, the UK scene, Scotland scene, that you see come into FCW to maybe test your limits of what you can do?
Give his Talon Jr. again.
There you go. Talon Jr. I've heard his dad's a terrible person. Old Talon Sr. Just a rumor though. So we've got Sam Barclay asking, out of everyone at DAPW, I respect that you call it DAPW. I hate Tap Dub. Who would you like to have a match with?
I'm at every training session at DAPW, so I've seen everyone who's walked in the door, who's walked out the door. So it's tough to pick someone. Say Kieran Douglas.
Think that might be happening sooner rather than later, with everything going on. I think with Patrick trying to get the scoop in the comments. what about body guy Brandon? I heard he's got a bit of beef with you.
I would love to wrestle that guy.
We'll see if that happens in the future. We've got the perfect balance asking, what kebab is Spike Tierney? So you've got, of course, your finishing move, the abracadabra, which I think's been in our top three best moves of the year for like the last 3 years in our award votes. But abracadabra there. So what's your favourite? What kebab is Spike Tierney?
Only the best. Nice thin doner, mate. Got to be piping hot. Covered in chili sauce. No salad.
See, I like a little bit of salad just so I feel healthy. Even if it is just like three strips of lettuce. And I go, it's fine. It's got salad. It's all good.
I could accept onion, but anything else is...
It's a waste. It's rabbit food. Yeah. The rest of it. I'll tell you mine because I don't think you're gonna like the answer. So I used to be able to get, there's a kebab house in Elgin. It opens intermittently, but it used to do it, a pit of bread, get your salad, so you get your lettuce, onions, no tomato. Tomato can fuck off. It would be chicken doner. So the stuff that they would carve off the big thing. Bit of cheese on top. Big dollop of garlic sauce. Which leads me into my next question. Tom Humphries, why don't you like cheese?
Some people like some foods and don't like others. I'm quite fussy in what I like. Cheese is one of those foods that I don't like.
So this is the first question that came in on Instagram when I announced that you were coming on, and it was... I don't know whether I'm just getting old, but as soon as that came in, I was like, what the fuck? Who am I getting onto this show who doesn't like cheese? Like, I know lactose intolerant people that still like cheese. They shouldn't, but they do. So,
it's weird, though, because, like I said, I don't like cheese, but I can eat pizza. I'll have cheese on my pizza.
I know a guy like that. That's weird. I've got a mate like that who won't like cheese, won't eat cheese. Don't know why I'm still fat, to be honest. But you'll eat pizza. And I'm just like going, it's just cooked cheese. How is this any different? But, you know, each to their own, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
Just judge you. I was going to say silently, but I don't think I've really been very silent about judging. So going forward then. So we've got the new group. I've been told by Mr. Atlas that we'll probably find out what this group is called by the time that we may know by the time this episode comes out. We know that Fallen Gods are specifically Tom and Sebastian. So going forward, as like I was saying earlier, you've been so long being the good guy, the guy who does the flashy moves and does all that kind of stuff. Going forward, you're not looking for that adulation. You're now going to have to be ruthless. Is that exciting for you as a new challenge that you're gonna have to totally spin like 180 everything that you've kind of worked up with a rapport with a crowd that you're now gonna have to take that away and be an arsehole basically?
Definitely something I'm looking forward to. Like you say, it's been since 2016 I have been the good guy. So this late in to change it up, it's an exciting challenge.
Have you went on Amazon and found a black mask, you know, just to mix it up a little bit? I don't know. I'm just throwing it out.
All will be revealed.
By the time this comes out, a show will have happened April 5th. Mm-hmm. I don't know why I'm plugging it because it's past. But yeah. keep an eye on Fair City Wrestling socials for everything going on there. We can't really speak about anything more about this new group because it's just formed as of as we're recording this. So looking ahead to the future then, is there any places that, again, get the vibe that if I ask you is there any place you want to go, you're going to go, no, I just want to go wrestle places and then that's it. But if there is there any places on a bucket list that you've got that you want to at least wrestle in front of that audience in the UK, like I'm trying to think of places as an example, like Rev Pro, is that something you'd want to do? Or do you have a bucket list, basically?
No bucket list, but like I say, to say again, it's sort of a case of if anybody wants me or to ask, I would say yeah.
Mm-hmm. So there you go. So if anyone wants a mass wrestler on their show, get in touch with Spike Tierney somehow. So yeah, usually I end with like stuff like that, fact spooking bucket lists, but again, like I say, for the vibe that we're getting on the show, you're just you're very chill, so you're just like,
yeah,
cool, I'll just, who have you got me up against? Ah, oh, cool, I'll wrestle them, that's fine.
Essentially, yeah,
happening in 5 minutes, sweet, okay, cool, let's just go. Which again baffles me to the max. I'm going to throw out some sponsor ads because I like doing that now. I've tried to, at least. Manscaped, I don't know if you are aware of the company Manscaped.
I've heard of them, yeah.
Yeah. So SWN20, manscaped.com, get yourself 20% off with free shipping. Keep your balls nice and trim. That's the only sponsor I've got. I'm still hoping to get one for Brewtoon. I called it Identity. I picked up Identity Crisis for this particular episode because now you're a bad guy. So, like, you know, there's some thought and planning in these shows. It's incredible. Yeah. Not a lot of thought and planning, but there's some. But yeah, so to what I talked about, yeah, not having a bucket list, but go on, give me something. Is there anyone that you've seen on the internet or seen at a FCW show? Anyone? Go on. Who would you like to? It could be wild and crazy. Who's out there?
A promotion or opponent?
Either. I'll take either. Put you on the spot. Put the pressure on.
I've seen a few clips from Pursuit Pro on Instagram. That looks like a good place to work.
There we go. That's. I cracked them. I cracked the chilled layback exterior and I got an answer. Journalism. But this has been a great chat. Like I said, a long time coming. I'm glad that we finally... Mm-hmm. sat down and talked a little bit of wrestling. I'm still, I'll go and try to do a pillow about how someone can hate cheese. But that's a cross I will bear. Where do people find out about Spike Tierney online if they so wish?
I've got Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. They're all just at Spike Tierney.
Easy. Nice and easy. And yeah. Fine. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me today. I'm glad we got this done, and we'll find out what's happening in Fair City Wrestling by the time this episode comes out. So by the time we're listening to this, you're listening to this as people, as viewers, Spike could be the absolute biggest bastard in the world, and we've just had a nice chill chat about wrestling. So nice throwback to a nicer time. Great. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having us.